everybody. I'm Heather Gooch. I'm not going to talk very much. I'm going to let my team do most of the talking. But when Robin called me and asked me to come speak, I was so excited about this opportunity to talk about these two really great projects that we have going on out of USC in Columbia at the Von Escala Martel Development Research Center. And my whole adult life has been working in some capacity to support children with disabilities, and my entree into early childhood was as an early interventionist in Charleston and Buffalo counties, and I found that job in the newspaper and didn't even know it was a thing, and didn't even know I wanted to work with babies and preschoolers and toddlers, and I did, and here I am today. So, you know, American success story. But Teresa and Kim are my my team members who are going to talk about how the Inclusion Collaborative supports parents doing child care referral, and how we support child care providers or after school providers to fill their toolboxes with practices that they can use to include children with disabilities in their programs. So I just am totally teasing this whole presentation. So I'm going to let Teresa start, and she's going to tell you about how we do outreach in the community, but we are a statewide program. So I know you guys are Greenville County Center, but we're statewide, and Kim is here because she's the director.
Hi everybody, again, my name is Teresa Johnson, and I am the referral specialist for the South Carolina Child Care Inclusion Collaborative. I thought I had this together.
Can you just touch the screen, I think? I got to get such a specific.
Now this worked when we practiced.
There you go.
Okay, you got it. It just needed to see you. Actually, what we're here, of course, is for public awareness and outreach. Our team does several conferences, as you can see here, state conferences, regional trainings. This is our website. We do meetings, all of these others, and of course trainings with DSS partners. Excuse me if I'm in the way. What I'm going to be here talking about is, of course, child care referrals. Okay. The referral process, of course, starts with a phone call, or it could come from an email. A lot of our calls may come from 211, and of course, this is our extension. This is my main extension. Please write it down. It's on this brochure. So, and everyone should have one in front of them. Keep it, use it, call me. It's there. The number is 803-777-8483, and of course, this is our email address. A lot of our referrals may even come in via email. Okay, that's my little graphic with all the people that call. Okay. All right, of course, as you know, Heather already elaborated, it is a team effort. We work with the child care technical assistant specialist, got that name right. And of course the CCR, R&R, and quality coaches. They're available in all the different regions or counties throughout South Carolina, okay? The referrals start with, and we always reiterate this, and this is our disclaimer, we tell them, although it is a facility where we send out information via all the providers, we don't endorse, regulate, or warrant any other program. It's very, very important. We do it via email, and of course, we say it verbally.
I have a question. What does CCR and RN stand for?
Okay, let me get this right. It is South Carolina Child Care Resource and Referral Network.
Okay.
All right. And those are the quality coaches in those areas, too. As like Kim is here, we have different ones all throughout the counties. Financial assistance. We also tell them via on the phone that although we are here to support you and give you all the pertinent information that might be available to you, no monies are absorbed or distributed through our program. But we are here to let them know of ways that, of some programs that may help them. Okay? And this is empowering the parents to make an informed, credible decision on any child care facility that they select. Collecting the information. This is where we get a little bit into the meat and potatoes of the actual referral. We ask them about their location. What county are you in? What city are you in? What is your home zip code? not only the home zip code, but maybe even their work area. Parents need, we need to know, where do they need their daycare? Is it going to be closer to home? Is it going to be closer to work? In that respect, it may even be, there may not be a lot of facilities by their home, so we may have to venture out to their work address a little bit. And that's the purpose of that. We need to know the ages of their children. That's very important. They can be, they're so stressed out that they may be looking for daycare for an infant, that they're having trouble getting into daycare. Forgetting about after school care. So, you know, their focus is there, and then once that problem is tackled, okay, now I'm thinking logically, oh, I forgot about the other one I may have. So being proactive, we also provide that information to them and generating some of the questions that we ask them. Birthday. Birthday is very important. Of course, was there anyone here from Head Start? No? Well, there was a parent here. We want to know some of the birth. We want to know the birthday, because if this child is going into age 4, they need to get ready for 4K. All right, so that's important. Days and times, which are very important. When do you need your child care? Monday through Friday. We don't want to send them referrals if they work on the weekend. We want to be very specific. So we'll gather that information. Work with me. Oh, this is going on its own. Okay, let's get way back here. I'm sorry, folks. Okay, here we go. There we are. Getting a little bit more into providing information, quality child care, licensing information, financial assistance. All of these categories are important in terms of the parents looking for their daycare. A lot of times parents don't know what to ask when they're looking for inclusion type daycare, what questions to ask. So we give them a list of information or some questions that they possibly can ask. If you were a parent, what would you ask when you're looking for daycare? Besides, what are your hours? What are some questions you think you might ask?
I'm a teacher certified.
Okay, well, that's not on here, but that's I mean, that's a good question. Absolutely. What are some other questions you may ask if you were a parent? What do you think they may?
Student-teacher ratio.
No, that's on there. Okay. This is on there. Okay. that's definitely one of them.
Their
what about safety?
Of operation.
Yeah. Well, I covered that.
Okay.
Yes. I want you to stay with me because I did cover that. Okay. Yeah. So those are just a couple of questions that we provide in our checklist. And if you want to see this, I can pass this around if you'd like to have it. Something that we can have the parents look for and ask. Financial assistance. There are, as you probably know, it all falls under the ABC voucher. But there are different routes that you can go into to qualify for that voucher. A lot of times when that call is coming in, first thing we hear is, I need a voucher. How do I qualify? All right, let me gather some information. Let me ask you. Let me find out. They may not meet financially, but because the child may have special needs, or if the parent is homeless, under the McKinney-Vento definition, they may qualify for homelessness. All of those categories are ways that they can qualify for a voucher, which is very, very important. If you have a parent who's calling in, and I mean they are frantic, they're calling on the phone, they're crying half the time, and you're able to satisfy their nerves or you know, whatever the situation is, look, this is a possibility for you. We can steer them in that direction. We may not distribute money from our facility, but again, we are here to help you find ways that are financially there to meet your needs that may be available. Okay. Okay, again, parents may ask what are their rights and laws and so forth in here. And this is another area where we can provide all of that information. Again, our information is sent out via email for the parents. So they're hearing it verbally, and then they're actually seeing it on the correspondence. And we always end with, if you have any additional questions, please, by all means, call us back. We're here to help you. If this route doesn't work, we're here to look for other routes. Okay. Thank you.
other opportunities for questions, but yes.
I think I'm still a little unclear. So if we have a family that calls our department, for example, and they're in preschool and they need a daycare, does the parent call you?
Yes.
Or do we call and make a referral to you?
The parent should call.
Okay.
It goes a lot smoother because the parent knows exactly what they need.
Okay.
They know what they know what they're looking for. They know what hours they're looking for, what areas they're looking for, and so that can be a resource. A lot of times we have families call, and ADA really comes into play because
right.
we have parents call and say, "Well, I've called the six facilities,
exactly.
and they don't take kids with autism." We need to know about that too, because there's some additional education, and Kim's going to talk a little bit about the education we provide to actual child care providers, but there's some education we need to provide. One of the things our program is working on right now is developing online training modules related to ADA and child care for child care system level folks, the licensing monitors that go out, the ABC quality monitors that go out, and then directors of programs. So that we're sure they know, because right now I think a lot of folks just don't know what the requirements are. Even if they accept child care subsidy, they're sort of double covered under child care subsidy because they sign an agreement that says they'll meet the requirements of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973. Well, that is, if you take federal funds, you can't discriminate against someone based on a disability. They don't know, I don't think they know what that means, right? And so part of the responsibility, I think, of our state system is to make sure that we provide that education, information, training, and professional development. And also for families, we're working with Family Connection on these modules to incorporate information about families, because I don't think a lot of families know what their rights are when they're out there searching. Sometimes I think, you know, as a parent, you know, I call up and I say, well, you know, I need child care for my daughter, and she has, you know, she needs some help with whatever it is she needs help with. And they're like, oh, well, we're not trained to do that. Oh, well, thanks so much for telling me that, because, you know, because I don't want her someplace that you can't care for her. When really, the training's easy to come by. We're out there, we're providing it for free. So it's just really a willingness to do that. And so I think parents, you know, need to know too that they can push a little bit, right? They can say, well, you know, we also tell parents when they're out there looking, don't lead with your child's disability. Figure out if this is a place you want your kid to be anyway, right? Like, find out if this is someplace you want your baby to be, or your child, or your preschooler, or whatever, and then talk about what are the specific needs that your child has. Because honestly, and I know it's frustrating, so I was telling, tell me your name again.
Nancy.
I was telling Nancy, we do have information about programs that have served kids with disabilities before, right? And sometimes if there's a program in an area like that, we'll share that information. Just because, not because not every program should be open, but because we know the search can be so difficult. And if we can steer a family in a direction of a program that might be a great place and that they might really like, that also is going to be open to supporting their child from the get-go, will help in that way.
I just want to, we did a workshop last year called ADA Know Your Rights, and we were doing a lot of stuff around the anniversary of ADA. I've had hundreds of conversations with folks who say, oh, well, ADA doesn't apply to me or my child because we don't have a physical disability. And people don't realize that ADA covers all disabilities, even psychiatric disabilities, you know, and so that, and it's not just physical access, it's program access. And I guarantee you that 90% of the families you serve have no idea that that's the case, and so they just don't know what their rights are.
Right,
so.
Exactly. And so I think the more information everybody has in this process, the better, because then we can do it. The other thing, too, is sometimes we ask age of child, do you need help financially, those kinds of things, because there are certain criteria that people can meet for Head Start. Head Start's required to have 10% of their enrollment be kids with disabilities, right? So if we can hook a family up that needs child care at a reduced rate or free, Head Start's a great opportunity for us to connect folks. If we know that there is a First Steps partnership in that county or that area that offers child care scholarships, then we can hook that family up with those kinds of resources. And so we're not just being nosy when we're asking a bunch of questions. We're trying to make sure that parents have all the information that they need when they go out there, because it's frustrating if you're like, oh, well, I didn't know this or I didn't know that. Oftentimes we'll refer to Family Connection. Oftentimes we'll refer to the public schools for Child Find, especially if a family calls us and says, well, yeah, my four-year-old doesn't talk. Well, are you involved with special education? You know, we'll refer in this area to Help Me Grow, sometimes for families who need some more support with other kinds of services. And so we try to be relatively comprehensive. We're not all things to all people, like Mike was saying, but we try to. Yes, sir.
Is there a certain age range that you deal with? And also, what area of the state do you have most of your clients in?
We are statewide. We are funded through the Department of Social Services Division for Early Care and Education using child care quality federal dollars. Okay. And so from that perspective, through CCDF, we cover kids from birth up to age 18, or through age 18, I think up to 19, children can receive child care subsidy. And so what can the federal government regulate? What they pay for, right? So they're paying for subsidy. In South Carolina, pretty much our entire child care system is funded through federal dollars. There's very little state money going into regulating child care. While we provide support to any legally operating child care program in this state, because that's what the division wants us to do, most of the families that call us are infants, toddlers, preschoolers. Mm-hmm. Occasionally, especially at this time of year, we get families calling us for summer camps and after-school programs for school-agers. We've gotten a few calls for teenagers. We don't get very many calls for teenagers, and of the children receiving subsidy in the state, that's the smallest age group that's receiving subsidy. I think most of the kids receiving subsidy are infants, toddlers, and preschoolers prior to school entry. Did that answer your question? Okay. All right, well, I just took up a lot of Ken's time, so I'm going to back away from the
technology.
So, hey, I'm Kim McCollum, and I work with a lot of counties here in the upstate, but Greenville County for one. And as you can see up here, we offer training to providers or anyone else really that's needing this sort of training. We have training options focusing on social and emotional competence, managing challenging behaviors, teaming and collaboration, accessing community resources, as well as inclusion, of course. And if you know of a provider that offers, you know, that statement, we're just not trained to do this or that, or we're just not equipped or whatever, well, ta-da, here we are. I'd be happy to come out and talk with them, give them a call, and offer our services. So one big thing, though, that we do is training. We do have face-to-face training where, like a group like this, I would come in and train a group. And we also have some online training on the same topic. So just kind of depends on the needs of the group, of the audience. We're also right now working on some online training modules related to the Americans with Disabilities Act, too. So that's something that's in the works. And so I'm a technical assistance specialist. So what we do is we provide technical assistance to those providers who work with all types of children. But typically we get calls and referrals about challenging behaviors, as well as a child with special needs or a child that may have a developmental delay. A lot of times directors are interested in knowing how to help the teacher meet the needs of all the children in her classroom. And so that's what we're all about. We don't want to hear anybody not taking a child because they don't feel equipped. So there again, we can come alongside them in the classroom and coach and model some of those strategies and techniques that we may cover in training. We may just sit and observe and then meet afterwards and have a conversation about what our thoughts are, ask some questions about things that they've tried, and so on. And of course, on-site and off-site coaching consultation is available And there again, it depends on the need of the group, the provider, director, teacher, and so on. And of course, through all of this, we're wanting to make sure that we're providing access and participation for all the children, okay, right? I mean, that's the whole point here is to support those providers and make sure that they that they're able to offer access and participation and support for all the children in their care. Most of the time we get referrals, it is from a center a lot of times. Sometimes it's a parent calling to ask questions and to see if maybe we could come out or give their center a call, and we're happy to do that as well. So, and I have business cards. I won't pass them all around because I don't know if everybody is interested in technical assistance here in the upstate, but I've got plenty of cards, so just help yourself. Because what would happen is if you needed, if you knew of a provider that needed some support for the teachers and staff, dealing with challenging behavior, special needs, inclusion, however, I would be the one that would come out and work with those groups. Yes, sir.
Do you work with private providers as well?
Yes. Oh, absolutely. Yes.
Anybody who's legally providing child care in South Carolina, by legally I mean...
Even a group home, family,
if there's a family child care situation that keeps three kids in her home and she needs support, we can provide
Okay, even if they're not licensed for DHEC.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, I mean, if somebody's providing underground child care and the state doesn't know about them,
that's kind of different.
That's a whole other thing.
Well, there's a lot of different classifications.
Yeah.
There's child care, there's daycare, there's...
There's registered faith-based.
Yes.
Exactly. Yep. Let's say registered faith-based.
Right.
Absolutely.
Can you help them?
Absolutely. Yep. Yep. And actually, Kim just presented at a conference. Didn't you just present at the conference for faith-based?
Oh, yes. Yes. Not too long ago. So, yeah, I was just at First Baptist Greenville a couple weeks ago working with a classroom out there. So, yeah.
Yeah, and if, you know, I tell groups of people like this all the time. If you're not sure if we're the people that can help you, call us anyway.
Yeah.
Because we might be the people that can help you.
And if not, we'll put you in touch with who can help you.
We'll try really, really hard to connect to you with who you need to be connected with, which I think what Mike was saying about this group is that's what you guys are trying to do amongst each other. So we're just joining your group a little bit. Yeah, we're just going to be part of the family, if that's okay.
And I am excited to work with you guys. You definitely give me a call. So kudos to you. So.
I said I was going to talk very much, and I lie sometimes.
She's going to talk. It's okay.
I just tell lies a lot. That's why I brought you the pens, because if I bring pens to people and they like me, they don't care that I lie. So we also have some special kind of initiatives that we do as part of this. One of the things that we do is we have an online screening tool for child care providers that we have about 50 programs across the state that use. Some in Greenville County use it. And they provide screening for all their kids in the program at least twice a year. And this the online system is set up to be able to have the teacher complete the screening and have the parent complete the screening, and they can talk to each other about the results, and they can make referrals if they need to either BabyNet or to the public preschool program. So that's one of the options. And then we also do training on the hard copy version if somebody doesn't have internet in their center and they can't use the online system. We provide that. We have online training modules for providers for both of these now. We develop those, so it makes it even easier for programs to access developing screening. And you say, what does screening have to do with inclusion? Well, childcare is a lot of times where we find kids who need support. A lot of times it's the preschool teacher, even the toddler teacher, that figures out that something's going on. What screening, I think, has helped a lot of providers with it is it sort of gives them some confirmation of the concerns that they have and an easier platform to be able to talk to parents about those concerns, right? And then be able to get hooked up with the right people to help. And then CARES Kit is toddlers and preschoolers. But it's creating adaptations for routines and activities. It's a process teachers can go through to decide what's working in my classroom and what's not? Do I need to make a modification or an adaptation to what I'm doing to really provide meaningful participation for all of my kids, even my children who might have disabilities? The good news about Kara's Kid is that it kind of is good for all little kids. So even if a child doesn't have an identified disability, with little kids we know that everybody needs a little bit of something different at some point, right? For whatever reason. And so this is a way for us to help them. And this provides our child care provider who work. It's a training coaching combination. Child care providers in South Carolina have to have 15 training hours every year. And we can provide all 15 training hours with this one training coaching. It's really driven by the staff in the classroom, which is why I really love it, because I can come in and I can look around and I can say, oh, you need to change all this business. But if that's not what they're needing, then me coming in has not been helpful, right? Have you guys ever been coached by somebody who did not get what you were needing coached with for whatever reason? Yeah. It's not fun. And you're like, are you done? Are you done? Can you just go? I need to get back to my life. And so that process is very teacher-driven. And so it might be that the thing that bothers me the most in the classroom is not the thing that bothers the teacher the most. And she's the one there every day, all the time, and she's the one that needs to decide, or he's the one that needs to decide what I want to work on. Okay, so we help with that. Okay. Oh, collaboration. Is it going to work? Oh, it did. So one of the things when we established the Inclusion Collaborative in 2012 is that we really, really wanted to work with other people who were doing the same thing. So this model that Mike's talking about just making sure I know who's in this space of supporting people with disabilities, families of children with disabilities, and early childhood. I mean, I think in, you know, early childhood is such a segmented field anyway, right? Because you've got DSS involved, you've got First Steps involved, you've got DDSN involved, you've got now DHHS is going to be involved because they're going to be the lead agency for BabyNet. And so I am pushy, and I weasel my way in to meetings. And so when Robin said, oh, can you talk with her? I was like, yes, we can. We can certainly talk for an hour too. I will take a mile and then take another one too. So I've kind of weaseled my way in with a lot of these different organizations, at least at the state level, because I think it's important for us to make sure that when we're talking about early childhood initiatives, we're talking about early childhood initiatives that are inclusive of children with disabilities. So I weaseled my way into the committees that are working on the early learning standards, and I weaseled my way into the State Advisory Council on Students with Disabilities and said preschool matters, right? So so that we can, you know, so that we're all in this together. This is really fun. So when I was a graduate student at USC, we got a grant to infuse information about inclusion across the curriculum in early childhood at our technical colleges. All of our technical colleges have the same basic curriculum for their early childhood programs. And so instead of having the one class about supporting kids with disabilities or exceptionalities, we were like, we can talk about this all along and along. And so what it became is an online resource database, and it's searchable by topic. So I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna like switch. I think. Look at me go.
There you go.
Look at that. Okay. And so if you go to resources and you do search by topic, we have all sorts of assistive technology. It'll give you resources. And I'm telling you, it's not just any old thing we put in here. I've looked at almost all of the 300 links and resources. Most of them are free or cheap. And it's been really helpful. We thought that project ended, and we wanted this database to continue to live. And it's a great resource for child care providers. It's also a great resource still for technical college faculty. So if you know any of those, oops, they can search by their course number. And there's all of the resources that we attached to that course content. Pretty cool, huh? Say it's cool. I gave you a
minute. Very cool.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Is
You're very brave to go back and forth between PowerPoint and the website.
I know.
Dana, I'm back, or Rebecca, back here.
Susie, just with the technical colleges? Align coursework.
Yeah, just with the technical colleges. The focus of the grant was, it was called a paraprofessional pre-service development grant or something like that with Office of Special Education Programs. And so there were several of these across the country, and different folks did it different ways. There was one in North Carolina. North Carolina has done webinars every month with faculty on those kinds of things. And we took this tack on it. And of course, when those projects end, the money ends. And so for us to be able to continue to provide this has been really, really fun, especially since I spent so many hours in my pajamas searching around the internet, which you know you can get lost in a rabbit hole super fast. Okay. And the last thing, right? I told Carrie to give me the hook very soon. Yes, the Champions for Young Children Symposium was born out of the Advisory Council for Students with Disabilities. We have a preschool committee, and that committee is tasked with sort of all things preschool. We've had a dream for a number of years to have a cross-sector professional development experience where all those different folks from early childhood can kind of come together, be together, and learn together. And so this will be our third year. And it'll be in Columbia. So if you're an early childhood person and this is your wheelhouse, we would love to have you. If you know early childhood people and this is their wheelhouse, we would love to have them too. It's relatively low cost, it's like $35 a person for an entire day. And you get breakfast and lunch. So, food. Maybe more pens. Do you have any questions about just what Inclusion Collaborative is about before we move on to our other project? I did such a great job. Okay, we also have this, but you have our brochure that has all that information.
And her whole staff is signing in on their sign-in sheet, so you'll get an email with all of the contact information as well.
You're doing great. Hello, good afternoon. I am Carrie Kenningizer, and I'm the project coordinator and for Partnerships for Inclusion, South Carolina Partnerships for Inclusion. So I am not part of the Inclusion Collaborative for Childcare, but I'll tell you more about kind of Heather's other baby. This is a sister project. So my contact information is also on the white piece of paper that you have that says about us on the back, but I'm happy to pull that page back up if it's helpful for you. So our mission is similar. We are increasing inclusive opportunities and school readiness for our preschoolers with disabilities or IEPs, individualized education plans. And really, we are guided by the Council for Exceptional Children's Division on Early Childhood and NACI's Joint Position Paper or Statement on Childhood Inclusion and the policy statement that was put out in 2015, the joint statement by the Department of Health and Human Services and the Department of Education on their policy statement on inclusion for early childhood. So I mean, I'm sure you're in the room and you probably already know how important early childhood is, and we wanted to make sure that those opportunities for high quality early childhood settings are also available to our kiddos that have disabilities. Our history, Heather, back in 2015 saw an opportunity and she applied for a grant through Gateway's Cradle to Career, and in September of 2015 she was awarded that grant. And she kind of took it and ran with it, and thankfully she hired me to help with this.
Very thankfully.
So last year we were kind of, I guess we could call it a pilot, will that work? And we were known as South Carolina Preschool Inclusion Initiative, I would say. And what we did was we really took the time to develop a framework and look at a lot of resources, some of the resources that were coming out of North Carolina. If you're familiar with TASC, the Transition Alliance of South Carolina, we worked a lot with them and looked at their process for working with school districts and creating cross-collaborative teams of folks who are working with the individual older child, so we adapted a lot of their work to make sense for preschool aged. And we really just thought about how can we do this for our littlest kids in South Carolina. So we were able to put on an event back in August, and we had 7 school districts sign up, which was really exciting, and I'll tell you a little bit more about what we do at that event, but I think I'm getting ahead of myself. So we created some teams, which I'll go into, and then our work ended in, the end of September of this past year. But thankfully, the South Carolina Department of Ed, their Office of Special Education Services, has decided to continue funding this project. So right now we have a 5-year contract with them through 2021 to continue the work that we're doing. So, yay! So I alluded to this planned event that we had. So we are calling it District Leadership Day, and it's really a strategic planning event. And what we do is we want to help school districts create a leadership team that they can use this team to really focus on what are we doing well in our community and our district, where are the kind of the pockets of broken windows when it comes to preschool inclusion. So we have this event as kind of the beginning of their team development. So with really the minimal suggestion of, do you have somebody from early childhood and somebody from special education that are willing to be on this team? Of course, there are suggestions about like, hey, it's a really good idea if you have people who are district administrators who have kind of the, just the, whatever the word might be, the power to get some things done, district early childhood coordinators, district special education coordinators, but teachers, parents, community child care, Head Start, because we want it to be cross-collaborative. We don't want it to happen in silos, because then we'll miss some of the opportunities for really how can we best serve the littlest kids with disabilities in our community. So this event is like a 6-hour event. In the morning, we do kind of what is inclusion for early childhood, what isn't it? We do a lot of collaborative activities among all of the participants, and I think teams really like that because then they get to meet other people, other roles, other districts. But then the afternoon, we use our tools to help them dive in with their district teams to look at their district strengths and challenges, and then to create a 5-year strategic plan using backwards planning so they can really get started. So they don't just leave that event with like, yeah, we have a lot of great information, but now what? No, now what? Look at your plan. You already got started, and we're here to help you. It's not just, okay, bye. What we do is we have tiered TA, or technical assistance. So once you're in, you're always part of the family, and then you can, these teams can choose to apply for more intensive levels of support if they want to. And we're available for workshops, professional development. We're also kind of working on webinar series for our teams. And we're presenting at other events like Family Connections and the South Carolina Council for Exceptional Children, which I'll talk more about. We have our own website coming out in April, and that will kind of house all of the information that I've talked about, and our teams are also going to have a way to share what they're doing, because I think kind of that peer pressure of like, oh, but what's this district doing? What's that county doing? Because for us, it's not a one-size-fits-all. I think the teams come to us and they say, okay, but Carrie, am I doing a good job? What do you think about this? What do you think about this? What's the other district doing? It's more about what does your community look like? Who's involved in your district and your community? What have you already done well? What do you need to work on? So we always encourage all of the districts that work with us that it's not about having a lofty goal that you can't meet. It's really just kind of taking that step forward, because inclusion can be scary when we're thinking about, but all of these, there seems to be roadblocks, there seems to be this red tape to get through, and just really thinking about what's the smallest thing that you can do that you can work on with your team to really build it out. So right now we have 17 teams. The ones in blue were kind of our founding cohorts that we kind of got in, and then we said, hey, you're our guinea pigs. No, guess what? Now you're our founding cohort, so we're going to come back to you, and we want to know how this is going. And then the ones in this maroon color are our newest teams that just joined us last month for our District Leadership Day event. And we would probably have more, but we had to kind of cap it at 10 teams at a time because it's just Heather and I that are involved in this project right now, and giving the support and the technical assistance, we have to be realistic with how many teams we can take on at once. So there's our little Dr. King quote, you don't have to see the whole staircase, just take the first step. And that really is our philosophy. Then you also have a blue paper which has some information about a pre-conference that we've sponsored in conjunction with South Carolina Council for Exceptional Children's Conference in Myrtle Beach. So for their actual conference, there's a registration fee. However, this is taking place the Thursday before that, on the 23rd, and it is 100% free. You don't have to pay their registration. There's no cost that we're requiring. So if you're able to make it to Myrtle Beach, you can come see Aaron Hall, do this. I haven't seen it, but I'm really excited because I've heard raves from people who have seen his similar presentations. And even it's for early childhood folks, but also for elementary school folks. If you're thinking about ways to make inclusive practices fun, when you're thinking about encouraging play and friendships and social interactions with little kids, then this is definitely something you should check out. Registration is on Eventbrite, and it closes on the 20th of this month. And right now, I think we have about 20 slots left, and I'm afraid that they will fill pretty quickly. And then the pink paper just has information about the Council for Exceptional Children's Conference, which is on the following Friday and Saturday, 24th and 25th. And again, there is a registration fee that CEC puts out for that portion. What we've done is we've put together a strand for early childhood sessions. So we have six different sessions that we are presenting ourselves. We've also gotten some other folks to come in, including Rosemary Allen. She's doing a few sessions too on Friday about culturally responsive practices. So if you're interested in that, there's more information and there's some websites that you can check out as well. Do you have any questions about the events or South Carolina Partnerships for Inclusion? And I know there are some folks from school districts, so maybe we'll hear from you soon.
Jake's got a question. Jake?
Go for it.
I have something else. I compliment you on your presentation. You know your material. Your presentation is awesome. Continue. Thank you very kindly.